There are a lot of misconceptions, and it makes people fearful about aging.
The thing that's best about growing old is the freedom.
I tell people I'm probably busier in retirement than I was when I was working.
Too often, the aging can become invisible.
The hardest part is her realizing that she forgets all the memories forever.
As I approach the end of my life, I know that the world that I leave is better than the world I was born into. And that's one of the things that keeps me going.
Old people don't need to be feeble. Do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. That's what we can do.
If you had to stay in the house all the time, I think that would get very tiresome. I've just moved along with the times.
Carrying them around if I wanted to be 65.
And I gave up driving almost 2 years ago, and that's how I met Suzanne.
She finally asked me to call her Elizabeth instead of Mrs. Catterton, so I felt like that's a friendship. So I basically started taking all of her Friday rides to the library.
If you just sit at home and moan about it, it doesn't help a thing.
We're all gonna reach that age. We're all gonna lose that ability to drive.
It probably is harder for some people. You give up a part of yourself, because you were always in charge.
Your husband was pretty tall, right?
Right, he was tall,
very tall, 6'5".
Well, there you go.
A third of our population that without good transportation, they're stuck in their houses. You know, neighbor ride's awesome, but it's mainly volunteers.
Good afternoon, this is Paul. How can I help you today?
And it's not just a matter of getting to the doctor. They want to be social, and they have to depend on everyone else in order to do what they used to do and be whoever they used to be.
There are many ways that elderly people could volunteer. Even though I was a nurse, I really didn't want to do the same volunteering. I just thought I would like to spread my wings a little and go another direction. And so I did. I had always liked the library. I was afraid that they might have an age limit, and they said no.
I'm grateful that I can give a service to these individuals and hope that when my day comes, something like this will still exist for my benefit.
You just know that life is not going to treat you like a princess or something, but almost.
The thing about aging is that people ascribe limits that just aren't there. I sing with the gentlemen songsters.
We are the men of the music.
I'm a tenor, and there are not too many old tenors around, so I'm welcome usually wherever I want to sing.
Then, tenors, you got it.
I took a fling at acting and singing when I was in my early 20s. I thought, oh, let me see how good I was. Turns out I wasn't quite good enough, but I don't have that regret. I was in a choral group one time based on a scientific study of the effect of performing arts on aging brains. They actually have measured biodynamically or some way the increase in brain activity when older adults are engaged in activity like singing.
One, two, a lady wouldn't flirt with strangers.
as long as you're active, you can affirmatively forestall the limits of aging. Now, I'm 73, I'll be 74, and I'm going to remain active for the foreseeable future and see how much I can do.
If our love may be true.
And we have a lot to offer. Old people don't need to be feeble if they fight it. As Dylan Thomas once said, you know, do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. And that's what we can do. Ha!
Off we go, up to school. Oh, hell, sorry. I always do that, I forgot my key. It's one of the problems of getting old. My wife and I always go round and round. She says, you know, this is your golden years, you know. You're supposed to be doing the things you want to do. And I'm trying to tell her, these are the things that I want to do.
This class is a history of anti-Semitism. I found extremely interesting, and I think it's an important course, particularly today with what's going on, because anti-Semitism continues even today. And so here we are. Made really good time today.
And I go through Key into Talfiero, which is behind it. That's where the class is. No, I usually get here right about now.
The next paragraph elaborates.
And I never really had what they call, quote, the college experience. You know, I never lived on campus. I never belonged to a fraternity. The last sentence on 224 and top of 223. There were six students that signed up for this class. I do not really participate very much. Saying this is where perhaps some of that conflict came, well, as well as what this in here. Unless sort of nobody knows the answer to the question or something like that that he's asked. Yeah, I mean, I tell people I'm probably busier in retirement than I was when I was working. I'll send it to you this afternoon. I've got things to do, but I'll get it to you this afternoon.
Aging is, you know, I'm one of those guys that got killed in Vietnam that just hasn't died yet.
Parcel, Bates.
I was in Vietnam from 1969 to 1970. When I came home, became a police officer with the Monroe County Sheriff's Department in Monroe,
Charles
Michigan.
Frank Morley.
Was 20 when I got home. You know, now I'm 67. So a lot of things have changed in that. There's 20 of us here that tried to come every year. We all basically saw the same thing, saw the same horrors. Because of the diseases we brought home, because of the Agent Orange, is slowly killing us. They sprayed it to kill the foliage. I was exposed to it, you know, and it followed me home. You just gotta make the best of what you can with life and move on. A lot of vets still have anger about the way they were treated when they got home. It wasn't until they built the wall that people started realizing, you know, we need to show the vets some respect. Every guy in our group has a friend on that wall. We're united by the Vietnam War. But, you know, it came like a brotherhood. It is a brotherhood.
Peace! Peace, Dad! Pump! Order! Pump! Left! Peace! Yes, miss.
There's only one here. I work 5 days a week, Monday through Friday. Well, they call me Grandma Sanders.
Yeah, look.
I'm in the foster grandparent organization, and I am 76 years old.
The program has been in existence for 50 years. It is a federally funded program. They're all across the country.
Thank you.
that we can use with B.
We play games. They learn how to count.
Six.
They learn their alphabets. They learn their numbers.
That's a grade four.
Everything.
Monica, what happened to the seven?
I was, you know, just sitting home. Because I had retired from DC General Hospital. I'm a nurse.
She's gifted to work with children. I'm telling my kids learn a lot from her. Every year I request her.
What comes in a box like this?
Some kids, you know, are slow learners. You have to constantly go over the concepts, the letters, the numbers, and everything like that. And they eventually get it.
Very good.
Everyone in this class can print their names. We have some trying kids, but they're all lovable, you know, because they're innocent. They're young. They're 5 years old. When you're not here, they miss you, and they'll ask you, "Why, Grandma, what happened to you? You know, where were you? You know?" And some of them get mixed up with the days of the week. I didn't see you yesterday, then you have to remind, this was the weekend, so you were home with your parents, but today is Monday.
Grandma touches the kid's life in all aspects, and I love her for that.
Banana.
All right, I like bananas. I got one in my lunch today. You get a good experience. You don't have to, you know, sit home and do nothing or watch TV or stuff. You out here and you're glad to come in the morning and you're ready to go in the evening.
You don't have a hat to me, but bring a hat, it's cold. Yeah.
Welcome to Medical Therapeutic Yoga. My name is Veronica, so welcome to class. I am an integrative physical therapist. I take my Western training and I combine it with Eastern medicine, which is a yoga-based medicine. Pretend that you have a cup of espresso on your neck. The straight, neutral spine, engage your abdominal muscles.
So I'm primarily doing this so I don't have to take medication for osteoporosis and I can build up my bone strength through the classes.
Functional medicine practitioners are those who can help patients naturally, dealing with eating better, walking more, getting sunshine, doing yoga therapy, instead of just taking pills and being sedentary.
That stabilization in the spine.
I know that there are a lot of side effects from the osteoporosis medications.
With age comes wear and tear through the body. They are more susceptible to injury. Medical therapeutic yoga is a big distinction from not only yoga and yoga therapy, but also from regular physical therapy.
Hold on.
Okay. If we want our aging population to live longer, utilize healthcare services less, this will help to lower healthcare costs.
So when we come here, we're sure Veronica's watching us, making sure we have the right postures and the right breathing and the right core strength before we get into different positions, so I feel safe.
And I find trigger points. That's a good one. A physician writes, medical therapeutic yoga, evaluate and treat. That would be music to my ears. That would be beauty to my eyes to read that prescription.
And exhale, sweep the arms out together, palms connect, and namaste.
I'm 82 years old, and I love being 82 years old because I never thought I'd live this long. There are a lot of misconceptions, and it makes people fearful about aging. I'm a member of the senior dance team called Quicksilver. You cannot join until you're at least 60 years old, so we're waiting for you. Let her loose! I started dancing about 11, 12 years ago because I had some heart problems. In like 4 years, had 5 admissions into the hospital, and then I decided this can't go on. It's not always easy because you do lose a lot, but I'm not discouraged by what I can't do. Aging, you know, you're aging from the moment you're born. My husband died 2.5 years ago, and I miss him, miss him, miss him. But he was such an encouragement to me to move forward. when he was kind of at the end of his life, he couldn't speak very much. And I remember he motioned for a pad and a pencil, and he just made big marks, D-A-N-C, because he wanted me to go, because he knew it was my time to dance. You know, a lot of the dancing that I do for him. Shoulders.
My dad is, his name is Walter Simmons. He's 87 years old. He's my hero. He's also very strong and demanding and knows what he wants and has been used to a very independent life. So now he's not doing so well. He had his fifth stroke in April of this year.
It just boom, overnight. Went to the hospital. You know, I had one of those medical alert buttons. By the time I hit the floor, it was two-way conversation. He said, rescue's on its way, sir.
When this happened, it blindsided both my brother and I. I mean, we have an 87-year-old father. I don't know why we weren't really thinking about this, but I don't think our culture embraces the fact that every single one of us, except for the ones that are taken quickly, which I believe now are lucky, you will go into decline. You will go into physical and mental decline.
It's almost like what happened to my dad and to our family was the first time it happened in mankind, right? It's like, oh, we don't know what to do. Go figure it out. It's like, wait a minute, doesn't this happen to tens of thousands of families every single day? It's almost unfathomable for us to talk to him in such a way that, oh, well, it's just a new day, right? And nothing's changed other than the fact that you'll never walk again.
I was just paralyzed. Since my stroke, my legs are gone. Look at my hand. Just all the, I never knew a stroke could do this, do you, you know? Yeah, I'm ready.
He just was looking at me helpless and said, I'm helpless. It was a moment that I realized that all my life has been leading up to this, where it's my turn now to say, you know, you're only helpless if you don't have someone to help you.
Oh, thank you.
Are you thirsty?
Bring back everything
you took
from. We quickly found out how hard it is to give 24/7 care to somebody.
We'll be Skyping.
He only has the use of his right arm and hand, so basically anything that requires anything more than that, we have to help
him
with.
My feet don't bend that way, you know.
So he can't get out of bed.
This is an anatomy lesson every day. Okay, I'm down.
I will wait till she gets your legs out.
Okay. Can't really even move himself in bed.
Okay, yes, both of them. Oh.
That was probably the biggest challenge in all of this, was that we're trying to keep our businesses going at the same time of really being there for his beck and call.
If I can check back in today, I will. If not, I'll be here in the morning, okay?
You know, Dad was our priority, but we realized it wasn't sustainable. So we started looking for a place where he could live, where it would be comfortable and homey, but he still had the care, the medical care and the caregiver care. You know, he needs everything. You have to do everything for him.
Wait.
I always go back in my heart to that picture where, you know, he held me up for 54 years. But he's relying on me and my brother to hold him up now.
Does anybody know where Kathy is?
She's at work, Addie.
God.
imagine every 10 minutes asking, are we there or where are we going? What are we doing?
Where is she now?
She just does not remember anything past about 25 seconds. You know, so she repeats the same thing over and over and over.
Miss Addie has dementia. She's 88 years old. She's been here almost a year.
Aren't I going to go to a home?
No, you are home.
Who put me here?
One time during the middle of the winter, she drove her car through a roped-off area, a closed highway, and that was the last day that she had the keys to that car. It comes on so gradual, but as she started to develop symptoms, the relationship changed to a degree where I was becoming more of the parent and she was becoming more and more somebody that I had to watch out for.
I'm sorry for all the trouble I'm putting you in.
Addie need reminders. Hey, every 2 hours, Addie, come on, let's go to the bathroom, something like that. She's just like one of our babies.
Come on over here with us.
I have to admit, the first few months, the first year, we personally put out quite a few thousands of dollars for expenses. It can get extremely expensive. Some of these places are upwards to $8,000 a month, but I'm fortunate to find a place that's affordable. If she's in a good place, it seems like the symptoms settle down.
Thank you.
If she's in a bad place, symptoms seem to get worse.
One minute she could be one way, and then the next minute she could be another way. So that's the biggest challenge. You never know when, you know, Addie's going to be nice Addie or Addie's going to be aggressive.
The hardest part is her realizing that she forgets all the memories forever. It is the kind of thing where you have to take it in stride and sort of try not to get too emotional about it, because if you do, it'll tear you up too. But I'm glad that she's in a better place now than she was.
That's where you cook, right?
Yeah.
She constantly wants to go home.
See, it has your picture on your room.
Uh-huh.
This is your home.
Home is not necessarily a physical place. I think home for her is being with people that she has experienced home with, like me or my sister or loved ones.
I so appreciate all you.
People with dementia, they just still want to be loved, that's all. And he really loves his mommy.
Love you. I love you too.
When I did this.
You're going to be a lot older after you leave next one.
After you go to the ranch.
I often look at these and wonder how many of these people are already dead.
Yeah, that's right.
Just up to their calves. Don't get downwind.
Hospice doesn't necessarily connote a party, you know, a great time.
It's the lamp cord.
You're there to take care of the person, and the elderly feel much more comfortable having somebody with them.
When the horse smiled,
I was a caregiver for my wife for about 6 years. I was still young. I was 68, so I said, I'm going to work for a few more years.
One final statement, which I will ask you to read.
I retired and said, time for me to pay back to hospice for all the assistance that they had given me while my wife was ill.
Yeah, that's right.
To do the same thing with sheep, sheep dogs are used because...
Do you want your light on? No, that's the question.
No.
You
can
only get as 3 diamond home shaving heads. For the fast, clean shave you've always wanted, give yourself the Remington shave. A godsend. I got involved with patients and taking care of patients and found that was very rewarding, so I enjoyed doing that.
Roy, just keep loading him up. Oh, yeah. Now, next week on the show...
Okay, partner.
Take it easy.
Okay, you take it easy. Have a great week.
Yeah.
I'll see you next Monday. All right?
Yeah.
Keep working on that grip.
Myleah is down by cameo.
George Chandler. Goats in the kitchen and cows.